Hello, everybody. It is 10:04 p.m. Central Time on the 16th of November, 2017, and we are here on the Earthquake 3D live stream. In case you don't know what you're looking at, we're looking at a three-dimensional globe showing the USGS, EMSC European Agency, and GeoNet down here in New Zealand, so we can see everything that's going on, at least the best as possible, from our agencies going on in the West Pacific, United States, and over here in Europe. Before I get going, if you hear any kind of audio issues or back feeding here, I don't know what's going on, but we got sound coming back through, and I'll have to get that fixed, but hopefully you're not getting any kind of feedback on that. Anyways, we're live, and this kind of stuff happens from time to time. So, what happened since yesterday? I hope you guys have been paying attention. If you haven't, well then, let me bring you up to speed. A new deep earthquake has struck at 305 kilometers deep north of New Zealand, right near our letter D, which of course stands for deep earthquakes. Also, down to the south, in Christchurch itself, a new 4.1 earthquake has struck. And this is pretty significant size for the area. Now, I don't think it caused too much damage, but it probably got people's attention. Anytime you start to see an increase happening across New Zealand, we have to pay attention. Now, I talked about this just the other day with the deep earthquakes that happened to your north. You can expect new similar sized earthquakes to strike to the south, south of the plate boundary, between, what did I say? Between Christchurch and Wellington. And we said the first round would hit here. Well, now it's progressing down into Christchurch. That's not expected. Well, at least not in the forecast. But we have to be on watch anywhere south of the red line. And Christchurch is on the south end of that, unfortunately. Now, guys, here's what I want you to watch out for. Every time there's a new deep earthquake up here, let's say a deep 4 like this one. Deep 4 means shallow 4. Deep 5 means shallow 5, or something very close to it, like what just happened with those 4.8s. So you got a deep 5 to your north, and then you get a shallow 4.8 down to the south. So it's not really gaining any power, but it's not really losing much power either, as the power, the force, is coming up on the underside of the plate, on the plate boundary. I got on earlier today and I made note of what's going on across the North Island of New Zealand with a tremendous increase in activity, bottlenecking at Wellington and then going in a straight line down across Kiakura, now deadening into that 4.1 at Christchurch. But if you go back up on the North Island, this is an increase, and the increase is happening on the east side of the island where the professionals issued that warning, what, a couple weeks ago or a month ago, talking about the potential of a megaquake at this location? Well, now it's picking up with earthquakes all of a sudden. Now, what's causing all that? Up to the north, all your deep earthquakes. So every new deep earthquake, I would imagine it, how can I put this in a way people understand it? Each new deep earthquake, it's like sending a check in the mail. So every new deep earthquake is a new check sent, and it goes over and over and over again, and each new check coming up is a new 4.0. So you get four different fours striking up here, and then you get four different fours striking down here. They have a corresponding effect, usually. But the pressure doesn't just go down to the south in New Zealand. It goes over to the west, across the West Pacific, and it goes over to the east, into South America. So today, on top of New Zealand getting hit and a new earthquake striking at Christchurch, over to the west, look guys, edge of the Solomon Sea hit by a new 5.6 earthquake right in the middle of our areas that were previously hit. Take a look at it. Look at the red earthquake on the western side. Look at the pinkish earthquakes and the white earthquakes on the eastern side. Sandwiched right in the middle, there's our 5.6. Check it off the list if you're keeping track of fulcrum points and areas to get hit. Also, next to the deep earthquakes at New Caledonia, this spot has never been allowed to heal. It just keeps going, and we just had a new 6.0 earthquake today, downgraded to 5.9, plus a bunch of other 5s. So that spot, basically a 6, 5.6 striking here. There's some debate on whether or not these are larger, but I'm not going to debate that publicly anymore. We'll just go with the magnitudes they're listing. So 5.9 and 5.6, and those are again happening to the west of our deep earthquakes. So check off New Zealand, check off the fulcrum point at Solomon Sea, and check off New Caledonia if you were keeping track of areas that we named. Now, as I'm talking, a new 5.0 earthquake has just struck over here in the western portion of Sumatra, Indonesia. We'll get into that in a second, but first let's talk about the other noteworthy earthquake, the 6.0 or 5.8 that struck up in Japan. Well, that earthquake also sandwiched in between yesterday's fives. Take a look at it. Here's our here, maybe I should turn the rings down. See? Here's our new 5.8 in the middle, yesterday's 5.2 on one side, and the 5.4 to 5.6 on the other over in Korea. Add the 5.6 together with the 5.2, you get to 5.7, 5.8, right in the middle on the Izu Ridge, sandwiched in between yesterday's earthquakes. How about that? Now today, look what else happened. Boom, up to the north, right on the Honshu coast, right next to Fukushima, actually, and then up to the north at Hokkaido. So right there, two different sets of fours, so pressure spreading up to the north, as you would expect, after the middle fulcrum point gets hit. And this new earthquake right here, this 4.9, marked in white, look where it is. It's sandwiched in between the two pink earthquakes from yesterday and this, or from this morning, really, internationally. So here we go, between the two earthquakes here, new 4.9 pops up right in the middle. So all of our fulcrum points are being hit. It's so obvious. As we go over to the west, take a look at this, the new near 5.0 earthquake that just struck in Java or Sumatra, Indonesia. Well, this 4.7, 4.5, what happened just a day ago? Do I need to take this back? Look, boom. Sandwiched right in between the two previous earthquakes, 4.7 and a 4.5, we get a new 4.7, and I would say that's probably more like a 5. It's going to be a combined total of the 4.7 and the 4.5 on either side. But again, another fulcrum point hit. Check it off the list if you were keeping track of areas that we named over the past 2 days, right? As we go all the way over to the East Pacific, we told you guys last night South America was quiet, correct? That's right. We told you South America was quiet and there was no activity for me to really report to you. Today, look what happened. I told you we would see this happen. An impacting of pressure hitting South America all the way across from north to south. 5.3 all the way down at the south tip on the middle of our red arrow, indicating where pressure is transferring to. It's going towards the South Sandwich Islands, but keep that in mind, 5.3 to the south, and then all the way to the north, a 5.2 to 5.3. So 5.3 is on both sides of South America, and then where the two arrows point, we have 4.6 and a 4.3 and a 4.4. So within a few points of one another, so 4.7, 4.5, and a 4.4 if you want to go with the original magnitudes reported. So that's a dramatic increase across South America in one day's time. Why did it happen? Trace it back to the deep earthquakes that just happened over here. And lateral pressure was put on all of South America. Proof is in the pudding right here in front of your eyes. As we get up here to the north, this is also interesting. When the earthquake struck off the coast of Panama and Colombia, which we issued the warning for, this 5, same time, 30 minutes later, this 5.0 struck. Or was it this one struck 30 minutes before this one? The whole region moved is what I'm getting at here on a 5.0 basis. Again, 5.3 on one side, 5.0 on the other, right on the ridge. This all happened in the last day, guys. As we go up to the north, look, Mexico is an increase, and it's also gone on to land. So we went from 3s up to 4.8. If it were just to go another 0.2 higher, we would be 100-fold more increase in power than where we were yesterday with the 3s. So to go from 3s to 5, that's a 100-fold increase in power. Undisputable. It's just a fact, okay? So a 100-fold increase of power has happened here, and 4s have spread out from there, again replacing the 3s. So, in other words, there's an increase of seismic pressure coming in. No duh, look at it. So in the last day and a half, 2 days, you can see on both sides where the arrows point, that's where the pressure is impacted and tried to go around the plate at this point. And it's gone all the way over to here. But this means the area in between, under serious pressure, Eastern Caribbean, Eastern Venezuela, Northern Venezuela, right here, in between the two sets. Now, how big should it go? It should be somewhere between these two. So if we take the 5.2 and plus 4.9, we might get to 5.3. So watch out at the middle. That's the Eastern Caribbean between Barbados and Venezuela, okay? As we get into the United States, let's talk about this. Look at what's going on. First of all, the Midwest was hit yesterday. That's going into this morning. That's the pink-colored earthquakes. Since yesterday, boom, only the West Coast has been moving. And the movement that's been going on is still carrying on the slow-slipping section, let's call it that, the creeping section of the San Andreas Fault, topping out at 3.2, multiple 3.2s. If you add all these together over the past day and a half, we're getting to another 4.0's worth of energy being released on the creeping section. Now, the 2.5 and greater earthquakes kind of tell the tale of what's happening here. Pressure is transferring from the creeping section of the San Andreas up to the northwest portion of California, going actually all the way north of San Francisco, but the earthquake that struck south of San Francisco on the creeping section. And look at our line of 2.5s. This 2.5 is at a oil pumping operation in western San Joaquin Valley. And I'm going to open up a display capture so you can see these. We're going to be looking for a 4.0 earthquake to maybe 4.5 to be striking off the coast of Santa Barbara by several miles. Now, I've got good news for you. The last 4.6 or 4.7 that struck, they downgraded it to 4.3, first of all. But hardly anybody felt it. But I'm going to show you where we're expecting it so you can understand why we're looking for this. The reason we're looking, let's turn on our 0.0 and greater feed so you can see just today's earthquakes. I think you'll understand what I'm getting at here in a second. Well, come on, refresh. There we go. Okay, so 24 hours worth of events. What you'll see, and maybe I should turn the rings all the way down, you'll see a diagonal line spreading from north of San Francisco across the Hayward Fault, going down the creeping section of the San Andreas, and then going and ending into South San Joaquin. And right in the middle here, along the coast, it's quiet. Then we pick back up down near LA, South LA, going down to Salton Sea in San Diego. And down at the very south tip of this, they've announced just last week that there's a slow slip of the whole plate. North America is slow slipping. I can't even say it. North America is slow slipping across this whole section here at Anza Gap. So if this spot is slow slipping and this spot is slipping, then what's going on right in the middle here? Santa Barbara's under pressure. Now the pressure is only as great as what's been pushing on it, right? So you're not going to get greater pressure than you're pushing on both sides. That means we have a 4.0 pushing in from the north and down to the south. We have a block with about a bunch of zeros and ones, not much energy down to the south. That means the spot in between, the halfway point, in between the two zones that are moving, brings us in off the coast. Now let me show you what's here. So Google Earth Pro, here we go. And come along for the ride with me as we go to beautiful California. Check it out, see what's there. Got family there. Word up and much love to the family who are listening out in California tonight, most likely. As we look in on Santa Barbara's coast, you're going to make out a few dots here that Google has done the graciousness of providing us here. And these are aerial shots of the oil wells and the offshore platforms that exist a few miles off the coast. Now, I'm not against oil and gas, guys. I realize we need it. But this spot here off the coast going over to Lompoc, where there's two more drilling platforms, this spot is under pressure. How do I know that? There's no earthquakes there, and there should be. So if you see a zone where you should normally see earthquakes and you don't have any, that's a spot to watch for new earthquake activity to develop. And we look to the center of that zone for what we call the fulcrum point, so the middle point of the silent zone. And the middle point of this silent zone is off the coast, which is good news. Now, after that, once that hits, then we look over to the east, and this is where a lot of people live, over at the fracking operations again in the Midwest. So the Midwest is going to have to watch out after the West Coast gets hit with its new four in Southern California. Time frame on this should be by Sunday night at the latest. My forecast expires Sunday night. I'll have a new forecast for this coming week, out this coming week. We are only waiting for one area to move on the West Coast at this point, by the way. Our forecast for this week called for a single 5.0 earthquake to strike in Southern California. Now, we got a 4.7, 160 miles off of our warned zone. I try to get it down to 200 miles. That's a preset criteria I've set for years. So it was under 100 or 200 miles, which means that, again, it's an earthquake forecast hit. But I'm still looking for a new 4 in Southern California. But off the coast, still another day where they haven't reported a single earthquake off the coast. And now I am 100% convinced this earthquake information here off the coast is being gatekept, hidden, not reported to the public. I do not believe that there has not been at least a 0.0 or greater earthquake out here, and they do have the capability of reporting and detecting them, which means someone has hit the kill switch. That's all I can say. I don't know why. All I can say is that they're not reporting the earthquakes, which is troubling because that means they're hiding everything from fives down all the way to zeros. I don't think they could hide sixes or sevens. If they could, they would. Why? I don't know. So when we look on the West Coast overall, you'll see silence off the West Coast. But this is man-made. This is due to lack of reporting of earthquakes. I believe if you could see it, you'd see a huge cluster right here where there's probably an undersea eruption happening at the axial seamount. Now, I say probably because I have no proof other than hidden earthquakes that are being censored from this location. And the last time they did that, hiding earthquakes at this location, was when there was an eruption happening in 2015. That's all I can tell you. So if you live on the West Coast, we have to watch for earthquakes to strike out here of noteworthy size, but the professionals are doing some funny business with not reporting earthquakes 5.0 and less, unless somebody else or another agency reports it and catches them hiding it, okay? And I've discovered that through trial and error, trying to report to you on daily events. As we look in the West Coast, though, overall, we can still tell what's getting ready to happen. Southern California is going to get hit. And then I can tell you something else. For the people in the Northwest, we'll know when a large earthquake is coming in the Northwest when the other areas adjacent to the Northwest are also going large. So, for instance, Alaska. We'll know if there's going to be large activity coming down into the United States of 6.0 or greater activity when this area starts to swarm. Or when we go back across the yellow arrow and this area starts to swarm with big earthquakes above 6.0 usually. So in the upper 5 to 6.0 range, there's an effect that transfers across. Now the same latitude, this is amazing. San Francisco is on 37 north latitude. And if you go all the way across the ocean and you get here, you get to 37 north latitude off the coast of Japan where a big megaquake happened. Then you keep going across 37 north latitude and you get to where our other big megaquakes have happened past. We have to go back a few years north of India. And then we keep going across 70 and we get right over through where? We get through where our big earthquakes have just happened across just north of Iran, across the Aegean Sea. And we come back around, and it brings us back across the New Madrid seismic zone. So, our largest... Oh, and 37 brings us right near Mineral, Virginia, where the earthquake happened on the East Coast just a few years back. So, 37 north latitude seems to be a real problem latitude, doesn't it? San Francisco, New Madrid, Mineral, Virginia, Italy, Aegean Sea... across all the big earthquake zones of the planet, 37 north, really? Because guess what? 37 south brings us right in on Concepcion, Chile, Bio-Bio, the location of one of the biggest earthquakes ever. And we go over to the west, and 37, where does that take us? It takes us over to the North Island of New Zealand. 37, where does that take us? It's just south of Australia, over past our letter X, and where? To the south tip of South Africa. So I've got something to say about 37 north and 37 south. Watch out. And it's a matter of study that somebody should look into because it can't just be a coincidence that all those large earthquake zones where the biggest earthquakes in the world have ever happened just so happen to be on 37 north and 37 south. There's a reason for that. I don't know what. Maybe someone might want to look into it a little bit. I don't know. Let's go and turn on our 2.5 and greater earthquake feed for the rest of the world. Now that you know what to watch out for in Southern California, oh, well, let me quickly sum this up. Midwest, you should get hit by a few points less than what hits in Southern California. So let's say it's a 4.5 that hits in Southern California. By the end of this weekend, by Sunday night, you should be looking at somewhere in a 4 range, maybe even a 4.1. So it'll knock off a few points as it's trying to brute force push its way along the interior edge of the craton from Southern California over to the Midwest. We may even see a new earthquake in West Texas. How big? It will be less than what's striking on the West Coast and less than what strikes in Oklahoma. It's a transfer earthquake. So as the zone is being pushed, there's an earthquake that strikes, but it's not as big as the earthquake at the destination point where the impact occurs. Then, downstream, let's just go ahead and issue an East Coast warning right now. We'll go ahead and warn you for a upper 2 to lower 3.0 earthquake to strike by the end of this weekend, going into the start of this coming week. And the magnitude should be based upon what hits in the Midwest. And the spot, let's see, should be Pennsylvania going, or New York going into southeast Quebec. Okay, so New York into southeast Quebec. Canadians, eh? Get your Molsons. Get your Molsons. Okay. Anyways, word up to my people up in Canada. And it's only a small earthquake. Don't worry. It's only a result of the leftovers, seismic pressure-wise, transferring from the Midwest up the East Coast. Okie dokie. As we go all the way back over towards Europe, I have more of a dire situation we've got to talk about here. Okay, 4 days ago, there was our 7.6 earthquake. Now, we told you we need to watch for 10 days, but I'm really watching for 7. So we're 4 days in on a 7-day watch for the areas downstream from this big quake. Now, downstream means, of course, the seismic pressure that we're talking about here flows in a certain direction. Now, I'm going to show you all the earthquakes that have struck since then. And these are from the Europeans, so really it's only the last day and a half. Unfortunately, they don't provide a greater feed for this information. But you'll still be able to see it. A bunching up of activity here at Greece and Turkey, and then a spreading out to the north and to the west across the Mediterranean and across Italy. Now, this is the path that pressure takes. I told you 7 to 10 days we would watch. Why did I tell you that? If you're a new viewer, let me quickly explain. 2 months ago, there was a 8.1 earthquake that struck right here in South Mexico on the plate boundary. When that earthquake struck, of course, it broke the plate boundary and moved it by 11 meters or about 30 feet. The movement happened northwest and southeast. So 33 feet of movement or 30 feet of movement northwest and southeast from this spot. 10 days later, to the northwest, in the exact same trajectory that the movement happened, up here on the letter V, that letter V stands for volcano, and that's Popocatépetl volcano right by Mexico City. Just south of the letter V by just a couple miles, a 7.1 earthquake struck 10 days after the 8.1. So first the 8.1 struck here, broke the plate boundary, pushed it northwest and southeast by 30 feet, then, 10 days later, the pressure crept up to here and released with a magnitude less. That was 2 months ago. Now, here we are on the opposite side of the planet, but we're talking about the same kind of formation. The plate boundary broke right here, and I would be willing to venture a good guess that if somebody gets some GPS measurements of this location, they are going to find out that there was many feet of movement lateral to the northwest and southeast. Surface movement. When this broke, and the plate boundary did fracture there, so many people killed, so many people injured, entire communities devastated and destroyed in Iran. Terrible. But it's flowing, guys. It's not going to stop there. So it's going to flow downstream. So over in Mexico, if it took 10 days for it to move from that location in Mexico up to Mexico City, let's just assume that it takes that amount of time to go to the west here. Well, if it's going to do that, let's again get our gauge on where our 7.0 earthquake was. There it is. And let's measure our distance. So let's say it goes the same distance that it did in Mexico. That would put it somewhere here in Turkey, over to the west in Turkey. Maybe right over to the edge of the Aegean Sea, in between here and here. So if that's the case, then we have to warn the people in Western Turkey, Central Turkey, Greece, Southern Mediterranean, Crete, and all the islands over to Cyprus for the potential of a 1 magnitude less earthquake. So if it's 1 magnitude less, like over in Mexico, where it transferred across that region and then struck with a magnitude less 10 days later, then we would look for a 6.3 to strike over to the west. And that's what we're looking for right now. That being said, let's look at the earthquakes that have been reported. Today's earthquakes and yesterday's earthquakes tell the tale of pressure going across the whole plate. Romania was hit yesterday. Guess who got hit today? Bulgaria with a 3.4 and a 3.4 same-sized earthquake struck at the border of Bosnia and Albania. So you may remember, we issued warnings for Bosnia-Albania's border and for Bulgaria, and we told you guys that there would be the same-sized earthquake that struck. And we said it would come off of where? We said it would come from down here. Well, what struck down here? A whole boatload of threes. If you add all these threes together, it equals one single four. So a single four's total energy pushed today up to the north, and then it got knocked down by a half magnitude. Brute force trying to push its way across all that rock, all those fault zones, and it goes down to a 3.4. Then, over to the west, same-sized earthquake started to strike. Threes, this was originally a 3.4, they downgraded it to 3, and a 3.4, which is upgraded to 3.7, struck just west of Gibraltar. Let's wait for this to refresh. So all the same-sized earthquakes struck today, going across all of our warned areas. And that's coming from these, basically a 4. Well, what does this mean overall? We have to watch here for a 6.3. And if a 6.3 strikes here, the same thing will happen. It'll go across Europe, but it'll be 2 steps higher from where we are now. 2 steps. So if we go 2 steps higher in Bosnia, that takes us into the 5 range. If we go 2 steps higher down here in the South Mediterranean, it takes us into the 5 range. If we go 2 steps higher in Italy, it takes us into the upper 4, lower 5 range. And when? Well, within 10 days of the big earthquake over in Iran. So 10 days. When did the earthquake in Iran strike? Let's get the actual date on this. Struck on the 12th at 1818 UTC. Well, isn't that wonderful? At 1818, and I was originally at 18 kilometers. They changed it to 19. I guess that would be too many 18s for us to maybe think that something might be up. So 7.3 at 1818 UTC on the 12th. And here we are on the 16th at 431, or 17th UTC time of 431. So we are 5 days in. Now, 5 days in. We are halfway through the watch. So we have to watch here for 6.3 within 5 days. And then shortly thereafter, Italy, Bosnia, Romania, Bulgaria, and the West, whole West Mediterranean, actually, which is just insane. I hate having to talk about it at that length out here. 5 days. Well, this is going to happen all within the next 5, okay? And be ready for it. Now, where? Let me name our areas in Europe so we don't just say Romania, Bulgaria. In Romania, right here, at the edge of the bend of the plate, where the red line is, okay? That's where we watch in Romania. Here in Bosnia, we watch just north of the Albania border, right here at the Bosnia-Albania border. In Italy, we watch central Italy only at this point, at Norcia, going north to Florence. So Florence to Norcia instead of Norcia to Campobasso. Why am I changing that? It should be coming up out of here. The pressure, not over here. So if it was coming from over here, it would push up into Italy only, but because it's coming from back here, it's going to break across all of Europe like water trying to flow around a huge rock. And as it does, it's going to seek the path of least resistance. It's actually amazing that this happens. The seismic force that we're talking about here, and I've tried to describe this many times before, but I'll describe it one more time. Let me get a graphic turned on here. Hold on. 1 second. Okay, so looking at this is the North American Craton graphic. And I've put this out so many times. It's been out for years, and it's so primitive. It just has the black lines over it, and it's the old graphic from several institutions have this graphic. But look at the arrows. Okay, the arrows are force. Now, the force that we're talking about here are not the earthquakes. Again, the force we're talking about here are not the earthquakes. There's another force that causes the earthquakes. Do you follow me on this? So there's a greater seismic pressure, quote unquote, that I'm calling it, that forms, and it's coming from somewhere. Well, it turns out it's coming from down below the plates. Okay? So as the pressure is coming up from down below the plates, it travels across the plate boundaries, and it hits the edges of the plate boundaries, and then in a path of least resistance, tries to flow across them. So we're almost talking about the flow of a liquid or a fluid, fluid dynamics as it's called. And now when you look at the arrows on the graphic here, you'll begin to understand that when it hits North America, it hits that more stable portion of the interior portion of the plate, and it flows around the plate like a fluid seeking a path of least resistance. It happens that way all over the entire planet. It's amazing. So now that you understand that, you can then understand when we push up on the underside of the plate with a deep earthquake or many deep earthquakes, it displaces the whole plate. And as the whole plate displaces, you can see the fingerprints of the greater seismic force, and the fingerprints are the earthquakes. And you can know how big of a seismic push you're getting by looking at the number of earthquakes and the size of them spreading out from where the push happens. So the push happens, then you see a pushing out of force. That force is revealed by the earthquakes, and it's revealed along the plate boundaries. Now, why is that? As this force is pushing up on the underside of the plates, here, let me show this to you so you can get a better idea of what I'm talking about. I'm going to turn on a shell, okay? This is a three-dimensional representation of just the area that's affected by the earthquake. But you see this deep earthquake raised high off the globe, and you see its shell. Now, I want you to imagine it down below the plate, that shell, that three-dimensional shape. And as it's pushing up on the underside of the plate, guess what's the first thing that it hits? The first thing that the pressure hits as it's coming up through the magma and hits the hard underside of the plate, it finds these cracks that extend all the way from the surface here, all the way down through the plates. They're called plate boundaries. And the plate boundaries are literally spots where there's a crack that goes all the way between the surface to the asthenosphere. But of course, it's blocked off with rock. Many layers of sedimentary rock over many years of how many hundreds of miles thick, okay? Very thick. But still, nonetheless, it's a crack that goes all the way through. And when the force comes up, it sees these cracks and seeks out a path of least resistance upwards. When it's coming upwards, I believe there's a leverage action that happens, like a lever arm, if you will. So when a deep 5 or a deep 4 pushes up on the underside of the plate here, it translates up and out at an angle and then causes a larger earthquake at the surface. More power, like a lever being able to lift something more heavy than you yourself could lift alone. Using the lever, you're able to lift the heavier object. Well, in this case, the heavier plate is lifted and the force that's released is a larger earthquake. So, people who are scared of earthquakes, let me tell you what, we can remove the fear. If you're on the west coast of the United States, you're worried about earthquakes, guess what? Your earthquakes come from the West Pacific. So you got to watch over here to know what's coming your way over here. And you have to watch it like the weather. That's what I'm here for, to report it to you on a daily basis and try to tell you what's coming your way. So Southern California, one more time, we're watching for a 4. Not that big of a deal. Could go, I want you to have a magnitude larger plant. So if I'm naming a 4, I want you to be looking out for up to a 5 just in case I'm lowballing. But I think we got it spot on for California at this time. Now, overseas, though, this pushing, we are looking in between our deep quakes, and there's been several. We're looking in between our deep quakes for a shallower, larger, single earthquake. And that shallower, larger, single earthquake will strike in one of our silent zones where there currently aren't any earthquakes reported, but there's other activity currently going on. For instance, right here, no earthquakes reported across all of Papua New Guinea in the past 2 days, 3 days. We have to go back 4 days to get the last earthquake in Papua New Guinea. Meanwhile, all sides are moving big time down here, big time up here. You see it? Maybe I need to back it out so you can make out that silent zone sandwiched in between those two sets. Really, it extends, the silent zone technically extends from here across to here and up to here, okay? So it's a big silent zone, but I would look to the middle, the fulcrum point of that, for the release to happen. And we have to warn the people in Papua New Guinea, Eastern Indonesia, South Philippines, because if it's a big enough earthquake, all the countries there will feel it, including the people in Northern Australia, if it strikes on the southern side of Papua New Guinea. But we have to warn where the red arrows are. So that is the warned area in the middle, fulcrum point, in between our deep quakes. Magnitude we're looking for, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the deep quakes. And how big are they? Well, it went up to 5.5. So a 5.5 can cause a shallow 6.5 to 7.5. Like I said, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger. But there's something else playing in here. It's spreading. See how it's spread? Again, let me show you the fives and greater so you can really see this. Spreading across the West Pacific. It's kind of stopped here in Japan. The next spot that should start moving, North Japan, with new 5 to 5.8. Now that's a pretty broad swath, but that's what's been hitting. So 5.8 here, 5.8 here, 5.9 here, spread out evenly, which means the next spot to move is going to be up here to the north. Now we can actually nail down our areas a little bit better because we have a new eruption to report at Ebeko Volcano, or Ebeko Volcano in the Kuril Islands, which is right here south of Kamchatka. So there's an erupting volcano right here, which we'll use that as a cap or an end point for that, a bookend, if you will. So bookend on this end means we'll watch between where the volcano is erupting and down to the south, where our earthquake is. Halfway point, north of Hokkaido, Kuril Islands. Magnitude, well, we have to add in all these five to the south and the eruption to the north. That puts it at upper 5, maybe even lower 6. So we'll give it a half magnitude swap of upper 5 to lower 6, topping out by 6.2. So 5.8, 5.9, 6.0, 6.1, 6.2 in that spread. And we'll look for 48 hours by the end of this weekend, my time. So by Sunday night, by the end of the forecast. Ironically, this fully fits with what the forecast called for. We talked about every single one of these areas, and we told you to watch for a progression happening in the forecast last Sunday, this past Sunday, said to watch from here up to Japan for a progression of similar-sized earthquakes, quote-unquote. That is the quote from the forecast. It's amazing. And it all happened within the first couple days. We are only really halfway through the forecast as of tonight. When we look around the rest of the planet, it is nothing to scoff at. Hundreds of people killed, thousands of people injured in Iran, lots of people injured down in Costa Rica, but it got buried. The news story got buried. So if you guys look up Costa Rica, much love. Apparently some people got injured down there. I shouldn't say lots. It should just say several people got injured in the near 7.0 earthquake. And they were minor injuries. It wasn't anything life-threatening, which is good news. But big earthquakes this week. West coast of the United States, you've gotten lucky so far. And it looks like you're going to get lucky for the next few days, at least, going into this coming week. Now, there's one thing I didn't show you tonight. And one thing that I may stop showing you. Why would I stop showing it to you? The slow slip in the Northwest. Why would I stop showing? Well, I don't want to really go there too hard, but I'm going to have to again say, the people who run the network up here, are apparently back to, as of tonight, saying new disparaging things about me personally. Now, I don't know if it's a troll using their account. Maybe their account got hacked. I don't know. They're back to it, though, guys, up from the Pacific Northwest. I'm not going to mention them by name anymore. As we go up here to the Northwest, though, using the University of Washington, you can clearly see that there's something going on now up on Vancouver Island. A new cluster of activity has broken out. Additionally, over the last 48 hours, the tremors show that the slow slip is carrying on. Every day that the slow slip carries on is another day that we don't look for a megaquake to hit, but it also is a sign that the plate is moving on land, which means extreme pressure is building out to sea. Vancouver Island, north extreme tip of this, now swarming out. This is on top of Seattle already moving, Oregon moving at central southwest Oregon near Medford, northwest California moving at Redding, and southern California moving at Riverside near Anza Gap. All that slow slipped and is still slow slipping in California. But up to the north, it's picking up at Vancouver Island all of a sudden. So, the professionals said the slow slip stopped last April, and they were wrong. We've been watching it go on and on and on and on. The plate has been moving, and it's been moving exponentially faster over the last week. We saw that pick up. We have not seen the corresponding earthquake we would expect off the northwest coast. The longer we go, the more I worry. Man, I wish they would just start reporting earthquakes out here so I could just shut up about it and it would be over. And then we'd just see threes and fours and fives reported out here like normal, and we'd see them go across the plate and it would be done. We wouldn't have to draw attention to it. It would just be like the rest of the planet. They are actually trying to present to us that the West Coast isn't moving at all, and I'm not buying it. Not with the rest of the plate moving like this. Do you think we're exempt? Or do you think we're being censored? Those are your answers. Either we're being censored or there's no earthquakes reported naturally. And I'm not buying the natural thing. Not with what's happening everywhere else. Yeah, anyways, I'm not going to lecture on it. I just have to make you aware of it. They started dogging me again. You got to understand, guys, we've got a professional feud going on with several professors who have denied that earthquakes could be forecast. They said it was impossible, and they said, I'm just getting lucky like throwing darts at a board or shooting fish in a barrel. That's, quote, the American Geophysics Medal winner or the Geophysics Medal winner from the Pacific Northwest. That they've weighed in on my forecasting and totally dissed me. Okay, fine. They're the same people that issued the public press release about me to the KIRO7 CBS News and smeared me there, too. So I'm not shocked that they don't like me. They said it's impossible. The Geophysics Medal winner said it's impossible to forecast earthquakes, and we come along and do it. Of course they're going to be uber butthurt about what I'm doing. I don't mind. Everybody is. It's YouTube. That's the way it goes. All right, so much love, everybody. Much love. Do you have an earthquake plan? Do you know what to do when an earthquake strikes? Don't be scared. Be prepared. You have no excuse anymore. We know where the pressure starts. We know where the pressure terminates. It starts with our deep earthquakes. It spreads around the plates, following the plate boundaries, and it goes to our termination points where our letter X's are. So we know where the origin is, we know where the termination is, and we know the path in between. That should remove some of the fear of earthquakes, right? You now know that they follow a path, like traffic following a road or a train on a track. You know that your propensity for large earthquakes, now you can pretty much bet on them. If there's going to be a large earthquake, they're going to be happening on the plate boundaries and on 37 north or south. That greatly reduces your areas for large earthquake activity. And finally, now I'm not saying that's the only spot where large earthquakes strike. We can remove a lot of the mystery of the earthquakes knowing the fulcrum point principle. The fulcrum point, that the middle fulcrum point precipitates the pressure on all sides. So you get two fives, five on one side, five on the other. They add up together, Richter style. Do you know how to add Richter style? I can quickly explain. It takes 10 1.0 earthquakes to equal a 2.0. It takes 10 2.0 earthquakes to equal a 3.0. It takes 10 threes to equal a 4. It takes 10 fours to equal a 5. It takes 10 fives to equal a 6, and so far up the chain. So if we've got two fives, that's 5.0 plus 5.0. That equals 5.1 to 5.2. You'd add 10 fives together. Every five you add on adds another point till you get to 6. So if you add 8 fives together, you get 5.8. You add 7 fives together, you get 5.7. You see? And in this case, we've got a 5.6 on one side, and we have a 5.0 on the other. That equals 5.7. Takes it up by a point. So 5.7 would normally strike here in the middle, but we've got our deep earthquakes over here, adding more power to the punch, 1 to 2 magnitudes higher. So that takes it 6.7 to 7.7. And again, I've issued the warning for up to a 7.5. So they're overlapping. But that gives you an idea of how to add magnitudes together, fulcrum points, middle points, and so forth. That's just a quick rundown. If you want to know how to forecast an earthquake and know the principles behind it, I've taken the time to type it out in a post called How to Forecast an Earthquake by dutchsinse. I put it out in 2014. Been ignored by the world. Anyways, if you want to go check it out, it's over on my website. It's free to read. And over on my YouTube page, you can watch the video also titled How to Forecast an Earthquake by dutchsinse. It's about an hour and a half long, and it's me showing you the principles behind it just like I'm doing now. So you can apply those principles and use them yourself, and I encourage any scientist, any professional watching, repeat the steps. Identify the fulcrum point between the earthquakes, add them up on both sides or all sides, depending on how many sides there are, and that will give you the tally total of the pressure at the middle fulcrum point that strikes within a few days after. And it's the middle point. I just showed it. The whole broadcast at the start here was showing you the fulcrum points being hit. Now here we are ending it, and I'm explaining the principles behind it. So thank you for listening. Elsewhere in the Pacific, guys, we only have a couple more days to go, and I'll have a new forecast out on Sunday night. So please tune in for that in light of what happened this past week. Again, thousands injured, hundreds killed in an area where we issued the warning. We issued a direct warning for Iran. Now, it's come to my attention, Iran does not allow access to YouTube. So nobody in Iran got the warning. That's why there's hundreds, if not thousands, of people seriously devastated by this quake. They didn't know it was coming at all. Nobody was able to warn them. Even though I'm sitting here on a social media platform, preaching to the world, waving my hands, I even got on and said, "Salam," like some kind of incredible douche. I said, "I'm up here, salam, guys, trying to get your attention." And it didn't even get to them. They don't have access to YouTube. Anyway, pardon my language, by the way. I just, again, I feel foolish because now I know I'm, you know, can't reach them. So why even issue a warning for me except for to warn the rest of the planet that they're going to get hit? Seems kind of foolish. Anyways, I'm doing what I'm doing to prove the principles in science for everyone in the future who can repeat these steps and take it from here. And earthquake forecasting is not something that's mysterious. It's not something that's looking into a crystal ball. It's not prediction, that's for sure. It's based upon solid principles. And if you want to check those out, they're over on my site. Also, one final thing. Huge thanks to everyone who's been contributing on Patreon. I didn't realize it. People went over on Patreon and started contributing again. So the link is down below on Patreon if you like my work. It adds up. So most people do $1. And so $1 with hundreds of other people then adds up to a significant amount that offsets if YouTube makes my videos not advertiser friendly like they did twice this past week alone, saying my videos are controversial. It is I don't even want to say it, asinine. That's crazy. So thank you to everyone who's contributed on there. If you're new, will you please subscribe to my YouTube channel? We're at 225,000 tonight. I'd like to try and get that to 1 million by tomorrow night. So if we could, that would really be tremendously helpful if you could click that subscribe button and make my channel into something that people around the world see and get the warnings. In the meantime, you could take it and share it. That'll probably be the next best option. Take it and share it on your social media until I get the reach that I need to reach the planet. And that's what we're trying to do. I take it very serious. I know this is YouTube, but I'm also not just on YouTube. I'm on my website and on Twitch and several other services. I'm trying to reach as many people as possible and make it palatable. So it's something that anybody can understand from a middle school all the way up to a professional. You can get your head around what's going on. This is like the weather. So I'm trying to explain basic weather principles that are being devised by myself while the rest of the world is denying weather can be forecast. So while the rest of the scientists are saying storms don't exist and storms don't blow from point A to point B, I am saying storms do exist and storms do blow from point A to point B, and we can calculate their trajectory and their power and their force. This is the battle I'm in. They used to say it was impossible to forecast the weather. You know that, right? Now, still, they can't do it very well, but still, we rely on them for hurricane forecasts, don't we? This is like what we're forecasting for. large hurricanes, large storms. We're done. Class is dismissed. Word up. Peace out. Much love. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and good night, Truman Show style. And I will be drinking my Makoko tonight. Word, I'll be back if anything else happens too. I'm watching, I'm waiting, West Coast. Bada boom, bada bing, we're waiting for that four down south. When it hits, I've got family there that are going to report to me if they feel it or not. So if it strikes off the coast, I don't think very many people will feel it. Even if a six strikes off the coast. It wouldn't cause as much shaking as you would imagine. It's just, when you get off the coast like that by 50 to 100 miles, it's definitely far enough away to reduce the shaking near term on land, right? For my people down in New Zealand, though, that Christchurch earthquake, that had to shake you up. I bet you guys were like, what? No, rumble. But it's only a four. Here's the deal. You're only going to be getting hit by the size of the earthquakes to your north, as far as I can tell. If I see anything changing with that, you can bet your bottom dollar I will be on here at a moment's notice to warn my people in New Zealand who have been so kind, so friendly. They've sent me tea cloths and kiwi birds and just everything. This is the kindest people down there. And so I don't want you to worry. But a four is big enough to definitely knock something off a shelf, right? Right? It's enough to wake you up in the middle of the night or definitely get your attention. So now that your attention is received, or now that we have your attention, understand that those fours come from your deep fours up to the north. And if we see more deep earthquakes and they start happening in conjunction with one another fastly, then we will warn you for the potential of a larger earthquake. And I'm looking at the North Island, just like your professionals at this point. At that bottleneck point, northeast of Wellington on the North Island.